All right, hello everyone. I don't know if what time it might be where you are. It's good morning from here from Dallas, Texas. My name is Ashley Jaramillo-Kaysen and I work at the International Student Scholar Services Office here at Southern Methodist University. And I'm the Assistant Director for Programming. So I've been coordinating these webinars over the summer with the help of Kelly, who you may have received emails from, who is our programming assistant. So we are gonna take just 30 minutes of your time, maybe less if we're really efficient, but we'd love to go through today's topic with you. If you have any questions, you know, feel free to unmute yourself and say hello and ask, or we do have a chat feature where you can submit questions as well. And we are super happy to have one of our campus partner friends, Lottia, who works in the bursar's office. If you want to say hello really quick.
Hi everyone, good morning. So happy to be here with you. Good morning, Ashley. Good
morning. All right, so we're going to just launch right into today's session. And I just want to make sure if you all can give me either a thumbs up or something that you could see the screen okay. Oh, it says screen sharing is paused, so you probably can't see anything. Let's get all set up for you here. Okay, let's try this one more time. All right, can you see the presentation? You need me a thumbs up or? Let's see, I see a chat. Oh, perfect, thank you all. And if anyone feels brave enough, really quick, does anyone want to just say hello and maybe what you're studying or what year you are? No worries. I used to always feel a little shy when people would ask me on webinars, so I get it. Maybe later in the session, you'll feel more comfortable. So I work with 2,000 international students about, and we asked them, what are some things that you wish you would have done differently? Or just things that you'd want to give advice to new incoming students or students who are just trying to make it the best experience. And here's what we found. Overall, there's 5 key things. I'm actually just going to go into it one by one instead of reading it all to you, okay? So the first tip was participating in class. Participating in class. Class is obviously going to look a little bit different with all the virtual options this year. And it's going to look a little different from the pictures as well with social distancing, which we can talk more about later if you'll have questions with that. But teachers in the U.S. value participation, whether it's in chat, whether it's in, you know, asking questions like this. And in some cases, they even grade on it. And so, whereas in other education systems, it might be really respectful and really good to just be quiet and pay attention, while that is still valuable here, they do expect more engagement from the students as well. So some things that you want to consider when it comes to that is, you know, don't be shy. Ask questions. It's completely normal to be engaged in class. You'll see that your classmates will do it as well. And professors do have office hours. So it's kind of like a visiting time where you can connect with the professor, talk to them about, hey, I'd like to do really well. You know, what are some tips? Or if you're having trouble with anything, you'll see office hours listed on your syllabus, which you get when the class begins. It's basically the big outline of what to expect for your class. And many of them will probably host this virtually, but they'll still have office hours. Every professor has this. It's just part of being a professor here at SMU. All right, tip number 2. Managing your time. You may have already got a taste of what it's like to be in a virtual classroom. Maybe your schools before already made that transition at the end of the academic year. But when it comes to SMU, there's going to be a lot of things that you're going to want to balance. So when you plan ahead, if you didn't use a planner or anything to organize your time, now is a great time to start, especially if you're not moving spaces. Maybe you're going to be in the same building for a long period of time. Time will pass you. And so There's obviously Google Calendars, but a resource that we have is ALEC. I'll show you the full name again in a little bit if you want to type it, but you can meet with a person here virtually or I think they're going to all be virtually and create a customized time management schedule for you, which I think is great. You know, not skipping class. A lot of professors grade on attendance, so that's really important. And sticking to a routine, figuring out, are you a morning person or a night person? When is it best for you to study? And even the ALEC advisor can help you plan outside of your classes when it's good for you to study. Tip number 3 of 5 is getting involved. Getting involved is going to look a little bit different. I don't want to mislead you, but there's still going to be ways to get connected with other people. Maybe you're nervous about how to make good, like meaningful friendships in the middle of a pandemic in a new school. But trust me, you're not going to be alone. This is going to be the same for domestic students. So if anything, I think it might be a really great opportunity that everyone's already coming from a really extra vulnerable space of, I want to meet people, but it's a little bit nerve-wracking. And I think everyone's going to be a little bit more welcoming of each other, even more so. So if you're wondering, how do I find out what is available on campus, what's going on, what are student orgs? There's this website called connect.smu. And on there, you can just search around and find organizations. There's some, if you want to have a link to, you know, maybe things that remind you of home, there's culture organizations, but there's also so many others and you can be involved in more than one. Okay, and tip number 4, it sounds very simple, but taking care of yourself. A lot of times you just kind of forget to do that, or it gets hard to take care of yourself. So some of the ways that students were telling us that they practice doing so is by making healthy food choices, both in the dining hall or at home. There is a nutritionist through the dining hall that you can actually even contact and just talk to them about healthy eating, and that's free. And exercising at the Dedman Rec Center. If you're on campus, the rec center is going to be open on reservation basis to limit the amount of people who are in there. But the recreation center is available. And then practicing good personal hygiene. In the US, it's, you know, it probably sounds crazy to you that I'm even mentioning this, but in the US, having a neutral scent is super, super important. So if you're someone who likes to wear like the best cologne or perfume, or, you know, now that you're doing laundry on your own, maybe you forgot to dry extra time, or food from home is delicious, but the scent is very strong, so it sticks to your clothes. Just being very mindful of the neutral scent thing, because it really helps create a space where you and the person that or people you're near feel really comfortable being close to each other, even if we're 6 feet apart. And then tip number 5, and this is where I'll start to transition to Lottia, is taking advantage of the university resources. A lot of students at the end of it said, you know, I wish I would have used that more. Like, I knew it was there, but I never actually did anything with it. So some of the resources they said I wish I actually would have used were academic resources. The library actually has a lot of support for research, for student success workshops. You have computer troubles or accessing things, IT help desk as well. And then the ALEC is the Altshuler Learning Enhancement Center. So they offer free tutoring, writing workshops. A lot of students use these resources, so make sure that you are one of them. And then two others, one when it comes to your career. For international students, a lot of them want to seek work authorization. And while that's a process with the ISSS office, you also have to prepare everything else, like a US style resume, a cover letter, interview prep. They do all these things, and something really special to this year. is that we're going to launch a career prep program specific for international students. So if you're interested in that, you'll probably start seeing an email sometime later in August. It'll start in September. And SMU Handshake. Get familiar with that word, because SMU Handshake is a job research platform, or a job search platform, and also shares other tools for internship or job search that includes on-campus employment or just other opportunities. I think they're trying to expand to virtual opportunities as well, although I'm not sure how many are on there just yet for virtual internships. Remember, you must have a work authorization before accepting any of those, though. And then when it comes to health, if you feel a little uncertain about how you're doing in terms of your mental or physical health, the Bob Smith Health Center also has a clinic, dental services, pharmacy services, and counseling services. But if you're outside the U.S., counseling services, unfortunately, cannot be used outside of the U.S. because of their licensing. It has to be in the state of Texas. However, if you just need someone to talk to, it's also why my job is here, is just to make sure that you just have someone, like a point of connection that's kind of your next person after you've worked with maybe admissions, maybe you worked with Jeremy or Alex or Nathan in the undergrad admissions or graduate admissions with another department. All right. This looks like it's the end, but it's just the end of my part before I hand it over to Lottia. But a couple other things I want to mention. One is, again, make sure you have work authorization. I'm going to just stop sharing really quick. Make sure you'll have work authorization if you decide to get a job on campus or anything, okay? That's a big mistake sometimes people make too. A really special one is that's unique to being in a pandemic year, or hopefully not more than a year, but keep track of your syllabus, keep track of your class registrations, all these things, because if in the future, for any immigration related purpose, you're trying to pursue maybe a different visa type, you have records of all these things, that you've been a student, that you've been in some classes in person, some virtual, or whatever format you have, just keep record of all those things, okay? That's super important too. All right, before I pass it over to Lottia, who is what I call the financial awareness planning literacy guru, do you all have any questions you're hoping that we answer before the end of today? If so, you can unmute yourself and let us know, or put it in the chat. Okay. If you think of anything, let us know. But I do want to say a quick little update is that for some of you may have heard about whether or not you have to quarantine upon arrival. And I guess I would love to know if you all can share with me how many of you plan on coming to SMU for fall, or how many of you are doing online. If you want to put it in the chat, that would be great. But with the quarantine thing, it is encouraged that you practice a self-quarantine and daily checkings for those 14 days, but it is not required of you at SMU. Okay, so it's not required, but they encourage you to just do your best to try and practice those things. All right, coming in spring, deferred admissions. We've got someone's doing online, deferring online. Okay, so we've got a lot of remote instruction. Well, you know what, for those of you who are doing remote or online or deferring, this is awesome because you're getting to hear all the tips before you actually come here. So you're going to be even one step ahead. And if you're going to be here in fall, maybe, I know I've got definitely someone here coming in fall. You also know it before the semester starts. So that's really good. Okay. All right, Lottia, I've been talking probably too much for everybody. So let me hand it over to you.
Not at all. I think you are doing amazing. I even enjoyed it myself. Okay, so I need to share my screen. So let me do that. Again, good morning, everyone. I am Lottia Windham. I am located in the Blanton building. So upon arrival. If you ever need me, please don't hesitate to reach out, and I will also provide some additional contact information at the end. So just wanted to share just a few pointers with you about avoiding financial pitfalls, right? As an international student, your guide to financial literacy. Upon coming to SMU, you have access to this resource. It's completely free. There's no charge to it. Even once you become an alumni, if you still have questions, concerns, you can always reach back out to us. Everything from budgeting to building credit, to maybe even getting your first apartment. There's so many different experiences that you will have, and we are here to assist you in those experiences. So real quick, so that way we don't run out of time, do not let my slides overwhelm you. I'm going to send this presentation to Ashley. So that way, if you have additional questions or anything like that, you can certainly ask. So Ashley, are we good? Everyone can see everything. I don't want to just dive in and keep going.
Okay. It looks good.
Awesome. So this is a big wheel that I provide to all international students. We're not going to talk about each area, but the reason why I provide this to you is because at some point you're going to have an interface with these areas where your finances are concerned. The ones that I want to highlight for you really quick, of course, is scams. Just like college students are most susceptible to identity theft, international students can be most susceptible to financial scams. So if it sounds like it's too good to be true, it probably is. And it's really good to be surrounded by a community. Just like Ashley said, I'm here, I'm available, my team is here, we're available. If you wanna, you know, run something by us, shoot us a quick email. Hey, Miss Lottia, what do you think about this? So that way we can keep you accountable and make sure that you don't get caught in anything that is not gonna be sound for you financially. Budgeting is always gonna be key. If you've never budgeted before, we have some really cool resources that you can use on your phone or in your laptop, or even if you just like paper, we have some resources that we can provide for you. And then lastly, the other thing that I'll point to on this particular slide is the power of your student ID. Your student ID is going to give you access to discounts, to opportunities in throughout the DFW area, as well as throughout the SMU campus. So make sure you're utilizing your ID to find out, hey, can I get a discount, like maybe 10% off? Or even when you're purchasing different software that you may need to complete tasks for your classes, all of these things are gonna be key in your overall success, right? Of course, some of you guys are gonna be looking into some banking options. Please, again, make sure that you're asking questions if you're uncertain. There's all kind of resources that we can make available for you. And then did we have a question that came up, Ashley?
No, I was just trying to reiterate the scams piece.
Okay.
That one is huge. We have a lot of students who do still also fall trap, even though a lot of them might know, because they sound so real. They seem to know, like they know information about you. If you're unsure something is a scam, just hang up and call our office. If it's actually that important, they'll call you back, or you will be able to call them back. There shouldn't be any kind of threats or anything. So don't get scared if you get those calls. We are here for you.
Absolutely. And just remember, again, I know we sound like a broken record, but if it sounds too good to be true, and even if it seems like, oh, this has to be genuine because they mentioned SMU, they mentioned things that I'm familiar with, still question it 3 and 4 times over, because we don't want to see you susceptible to any situation. And then let's keep going, because it'll also kind of connect to one of my next slides as well. So once you guys get to campus or on your way, sometimes there's that question of, well, I'm an international student. I'm not eligible for financial aid. I'm not eligible for anything. Well, I wanted to give you guys some encouragement. If you are still interested in scholarships or wanting to find scholarship opportunities, there are some available for international students. But again, this all ties back into that scam piece. You never want to provide any personal information outside of your name and your email address to apply for a scholarship, or maybe even a contact phone number. If they're asking you for any identifying factors from like your visa or any of your other documentation, then stop. That is not an application for you. These are reputable websites that you can go to that have been tested, tried, and true. And you can research and find scholarship opportunities that are available for international students. I am a firm believer in scholarships even after you hit campus, even up until the day that you go to graduate. When it comes to undergraduate, there are not as many scholarship opportunities available as there are for if you were going to go for your master's and your PhD when you're an international student. That sounds kind of interesting, right? You would think it'd be in reverse, but based on data and based on research, that is some of the information that we found. I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with Western Union. Western Union is a leader in the transfer of money in regards to sending money overseas or even in state, but they have a foundation and they have a yearly scholarship opportunity that they make available that a lot of students are not aware of. Our office here on campus, we will occasionally have information that will come across our desk. That is maybe for an international student or for a certain population. And we try to make sure that we share that information with our campus partners. Also, we have events that we will host. And as Ashley said, you can find a lot of that information in your Connect, where if you just simply come and participate, that will give you access to a scholarship as well that you would be eligible for as an international student. Be very careful in doing Google searches for any type of scholarship and or loan opportunities, because a lot of times, as soon as you put that word international in there, you're going to go to a lot of websites that are just not reputable. So I strongly encourage you to take a look at some of these different websites that I'm going to provide. And again, you will get this presentation. I'm going to forward it to Ashley to send out to everyone. And you can go ahead and set up a profile or a portfolio in a lot of these search engines, and it will help you find and narrow down some opportunities that are best suited for you. Now, there are some loan programs as well that are available to international students. You are able to borrow long-term student loans through various private lenders. Now, the thing with private lenders, you know, again, we keep going back to that scam word. It's best that you always go through reputable websites or you go through those that are offered to you where you have a banking relationship. So we always suggest that once you get stateside to go ahead and set up a bank account. And a lot of times once you've established a relationship on the stateside, then they will give you access to other opportunities or other financial opportunities that that bank offers. But please keep in mind that whenever loans are on the table, they are credit-based, right? So for the U.S., credit is a strong way that they make determination on if you are able to receive money or not. They usually require a cosigner who is a U.S. citizen or a permanent resident. I have provided for you two separate links, one where you will be able to go to our preferred lender list on the SMU website, and also one where you can go to a list that is reputable through Nerd Wallet, which is not on the SMU website. The first one says with a cosigner. Typically, these are companies that are willing to loan to an international student, but you must, again, have someone that is a U.S. citizen or a permanent resident willing to cosign with you. Without a cosigner, that's where it gets a little tricky because that's where you get higher interest rates and or you will be making payments while you're in school. The same thing that I would tell my stateside students as I tell my international students, read everything. When you read the documentation that is in front of you that is being required for your signature, it can allow you to avoid a lot of pitfalls. It can allow you to avoid taking on debt that is unnecessary. We provide one-on-one coaching sessions in our financial literacy program. So if you reach out to us via email, and I'll provide that information to you as well, we can sit down one-on-one, 20 minutes to an hour, and look at some of the things that you're taking into consideration so that that way we can try and catch some of those things that can come up. So I did also want to just throw in here about our SMU pay system. Once you get over to SMU, you're going to see that you have two accounts. One account is going to be your tuition account. Here you're going to have your room, your board, any type of parking permit, your health insurance, all of that information is going to be in student account. Then you're also going to have a secondary account, which is called your miscellaneous. Here you're going to see charges from the bookstore, various fines, if you have pharmacy fees, or if you visit the health center. It's really important to know that you have two separate accounts, because a lot of times students take care of their tuition account, and then they may have a small balance on their miscellaneous account that prevents them from registering for the next semester. Please make sure to review these balances on each account. Make sure that you're looking at the payment due dates. And if you have questions or concerns about any of those due dates, or you know, maybe you're waiting for a wire transfer, just reach out to the SMU Bursar's office, and they're more than willing to work with you or to notate the account to make sure that you're avoiding any unnecessary late fees. As a new student at SMU, one of the things that you should know about late fees is that we can waive those your first semester. So, you know, there's things that happen that are way out of your control. But again, communication is going to be your strongest tool. You're going to realize that when you communicate with us and you tell us what's going on, and you tell us what your needs are, it gives us a greater opportunity to assist. So early intervention, right? So don't wait until it spirals completely out of control, or you're like 3 days from having to register and not being able to take care of a balance before you reach out. Early intervention always makes the difference in your overall success. We also process international wire transfers through Flywire, and then we also utilize Western Union. So it's very user-friendly, and you can actually find that information in your my.smu. Here is all of the contact information. Our financial literacy program is housed within the Bursar's office, although we share the Blanton building along with admissions, financial aid, registrar, ISSS. We're all in the same happy home together, but these are our office hours that were typically available. I will tell you, as the financial literacy director, if you have a need that does not fit into that traditional window, if you reach out to us via email or even want to give us a call, we will make accommodations. Sometimes we have students that are only available in the evening or on the weekends. We will do our best to meet your need, because we are here to help you be successful. So do not hesitate to reach out to myself or Stephen or Ashley, who are both on the financial literacy team. Because again, we're really here to make sure that you can avoid some of these pitfalls that can come along the way. When it comes to your money is important. When it comes to how you manage those things, it's important as well. So the last thing that I would like to say to you is basically, sometimes students get caught in the, they get caught in the, let me get credit cards and utilize those, and, you know, get a lot of debt where credit cards are concerned. That's another pitfall. I would strongly advise you to avoid that at all costs. And to really grab hold of the opportunities that are here on campus, whether it's through working on campus, and like Ashley said, making sure that you get the proper authorizations to do that, because there are ways to successfully manage and budget so that way you can find yourself being financially successful. We offer tons of workshops throughout the semester. We will do workshops via Zoom or virtual, and we'll also do some that will be in person, but of course, practicing social distancing. So it's going to be something that we'll make available on Connect. And if you have a particular workshop that you would like to see happen, we are always looking for student feedback. So we would love to hear from you if there's some particular things that you would like for us to talk about. So if you have any final questions, please let us know.
All right, I'm just gonna address some of the questions I got on here about meal plans, cell phone plans, and laptop discounts, if anyone wants to stick around for that. Otherwise, the main thing has been on here. So one question was about, you know, do you get a discount on technology or like laptops as a student? Having a student ID, a lot of companies do actually offer these discounts. So companies like Apple, Dell, I'm gonna share that link with some of you here. This is not a formal official SMU link. This is just a site that has summarized a couple different locations, but beyond technology, a lot of places, if you just say, do you have offer any student discounts? A lot of companies will actually. Another question was about cell phone plans. In the US, we partner with a company called Sprint Tax on a non-resident tax preparation, but they also have a lot of other good resources. And I'm gonna share another link with you about cell phone options. Let me get this right for you. I've got questions coming in about work. If you can work on, let me try to keep up with you all. You have good questions. And feel free to make them, they don't have to be private questions because I think it's great for everyone to see it if you're comfortable with it. Let me get the cell phone one for you. We have had T-Mobile here on campus before, but again, you are not you're not required to use any specific company. It's really your preference. Okay, so question for you, Lottia. If a student is coming, is going to be remote in the fall or deferring to the spring, how does that impact financial aid?
That's a great question. It's really a conversation that you need to connect with your financial aid advisor about. A lot of times when a student is going to defer their start, it doesn't have a huge impact, especially if it's in the same award year. So an award year is fall, spring, and then summer is optional. Students don't have to attend summer, right? So if you're deciding to defer your start to spring and maybe you were looking at a scholarship opportunity for the fall, you just want to confirm that that scholarship is still going to be available to you if you're going to defer until spring. And because of COVID-19, a lot of those accommodations are being made because sometimes it's out of your own control. You would love to be here in the fall, but for other unforeseen circumstances, you have to wait till the spring. But like I said earlier in my presentation, communication is everything. Asking that question of your financial aid advisor is going to be really key. If you don't know who your financial aid advisor is, it's typically going to go by your last name. So contingent upon your last name and the alphabet is how they assign who your financial aid advisor is.
And how do they go about starting to connect with a financial advisor? Just on their website? Or?
Yes. If you go to smu.edu/financial aid is the best way to be able to see that information as well. And I'm going to go ahead and type my email in the chat again. And I can also provide to you a quick snapshot of just the list and how it already breaks down to make it a lot easier too. Because sometimes when you get onto a website, you feel kind of overwhelmed trying to navigate and find the exact information you want. And so I'll get that over to you, Ashley, as well.
Thank you. Okay. Can students have jobs from outside of the United States? So if you are an international student, you can have you can be eligible to work, but the things that you can do are a little bit, there's a lot more rules to it. So you're allowed to work on campus, but you have to get authorization from the ISSS, International Student Scholarship Services Office, before you begin. You can't work off campus, say maybe at the Starbucks nearby or a restaurant, that is not allowed employment. However, if you end up getting an internship or after you graduate, you are able to get a full-time job offer. There's different things called CPT, Curricular Practical Training, and OPT, Optional Practical Training, which our office provides workshops on so that you can understand how do I get that work authorization, basically that approval that I'm allowed to work, to then take on those opportunities. But a lot of our international students will have on-campus jobs just to help get, you know, income coming through while they're students here. And then do we need to get authorizations for loans from SMU?
So yes, whenever you're looking at taking out a loan, there is an authorization process that has to happen. It's actually called a certification. So it is like a four-part series before we can actually receive and process that loan. So what will happen is once you're approved, you'll begin to receive notifications from the financial aid office of additional steps or information that we need from the lender or from the student themselves. Just because you apply for the loan and you get accepted for it or it's approved doesn't mean that that's your last step. So it's always going to be important to pay attention to the notifications that are going to come in your my.smu or your checklist items, and that will notify you when there is that additional step that you need to take in order to allow that money to be released to you in a timely manner.
All right.
Thank you. I just provided the link as well where you can find who your financial aid advisor is. And what I really like about their link is it also gives you the pictures. I'm a huge person on being able to put a name with the face. So that is something that will help you as well. One of the things that our office does is we're kind of like a bridge between the bursar and financial aid. And if you find that you're having a difficult time getting in touch with someone or getting someone to get you an answer that is clear or concise, you can also utilize us as a resource where that is concerned as well. We've had multiple international students take advantage of that opportunity because sometimes, you know, it's just, you get lost in translation, and our biggest goal is to be your advocate and to make sure that whatever your immediate need is or your immediate question, that we get an answer for you as quickly as possible.
Great, thanks. So that is all the questions that we got in the chat. If you think of anything else, Lottia's email's in there, and I've just included mine. We are here for you. I know there's some things that we're all trying to figure out, and we're here trying to figure out with you, but providing answers as best we can. So we look forward to having you join us. Our next and last webinar is coming up August 10th, I believe. It's going to be on our ISSS website, but we'll send an email as well. Thank you so much for joining us. Stay safe and take care. All right. Bye, everyone.
Bye.